Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Lost in Amber by Maz Maddox, narrated by Kirt. Prologue, Lance. 1922, Gobi Desert, Mongolia. Had it been explained to me that the desert was truly unyielding in its excessive and extreme temperatures, I don't believe I would have pushed so adamantly to attend the expedition. In my previous lives, I had always stuck closely to lush landscapes of well-hydrated greenery, even wandering into the mossy swamps from time to time. Deserts existed, of course, but I never had the desire to brave such treachery when I had all the comforts of heat and humidity to bring plenty of food options my way. Yet there I was, a naive human chipping away at rocks in a hellish sandscape I had no business being in. To think I had begged to be part of what seemed to be the worst mistake of my life gave me a migraine. I didn't even have the added benefit of being blessed with the proper amount of melanin to keep my skin from turning a painful shade of lobster red in the sunlight. The native humans of this land were dark and strong, the wild weather as normal to them as the sun rising each day. For myself, I was a fair-skinned man in constant need of shade, who was miserable most of the time. The whole damn trip had been brutal. Traversing through an uncharted no-man's land of endless sand in bouncing automobiles had been awful, and more than once I felt a very uncomfortable realization that I might be sick over the side of Andrew's Dodge. Someone had warned me that if any sick graced his precious car, he'd toss me over the side, and I'd be forced to walk the rest of the way. Thankfully, it never came to that. Roy Chapman Andrews was a man who had endless ambition and a knack for eyeballing most of his decisions. An explorer, self-taught archaeologist, and naturalist through and through, he charged headfirst into adventure like he was made of metal. The man had bounced around the world, searching for whale bones of all things, and somehow charmed his way into a fully funded dinosaur hunt in one of the last true scraps of planet that was unexplored. It was incredibly frustrating how well it seemed to work out for him. The method in which we chose our expedition sites were hunches and guesses, but damned if his gut wasn't an impressive compass. I was ready to tell him what a hack he was on the third day of digging, when we found something truly remarkable. I pulled my glasses from my gritty face, wiping the lenses with my shirt before placing them back on. I gently chipped away more rock, my fingers brushing the bits of loose rock from the bone. "Look at that," Andrew said, kneeling beside me. "We've got a skull by the looks of it." "A skull of what?" I brushed more dirt away, in complete awe of the animal before me. Its head was massive, a relic of a time when everything on the planet was grand and giant. Its thick jaw sported wide molars, the upper maxilla protruding into two impressive front teeth the likes I'd never seen before. Years later, this animal would be named Paraceratherium, but in the afternoon in the desert, it was nameless and mysterious.
"That's a good question," Andrew said with a laugh. "I don't think anyone knows just yet. This is why we're out here, my boy, to discover what beasts like these are."
He gave my shoulder a squeeze and a friendly shake.
"Have you ever seen something this magnificent?"
It wasn't anything from my world. When this animal was alive, I was still asleep, curled into a tiny form that slept through endless lifetimes I'd never be able to experience. "No," I said honestly, "I haven't."
"Good work, Mr. Thomas. Keep chipping away until we can get it safely loaded into the car. We'll need to ship this back to New York as soon as possible."
"Yes, sir." I adjusted my hat back onto my head after clearing away the sweat, my eyes still glued to the skull in front of me. It was the first time since I had woken up 7 years previously that I had seen something from the time I was asleep. A pang of remorse ripped through me, knowing I'd never be able to see the creature as it once was. I'd never know what it sounded like, how it moved, what color its skin was. But at least I had its bones,
and that was more than I could say for countless other species. Even my species was still lost, swallowed in the earth and forgotten. I gave my new friend a pat. I was happy to have met them. The distant sound of a firecracker got my attention, a short pop, out of place in the desert's quiet. Figures were materializing over the dunes, the strange explosions followed by shouts and yells. "Sons of bitches," Andrews cursed, grabbing me by the back of my shirt and pushing me down into the dirt. "Keep low, kid. They'll take your damn head off."
"What?"
I coughed out a mouthful of sand. "Who will?"
"Bandits."
I was dragged along in a crouched run, taking shelter behind one of the cars. A rifle was shoved into my hands without question. Andrews braced beside me.
"You know how to use one of these?"
he asked, as he cocked his own weapon, the sound of metal swallowing a bullet somehow louder than the shooting. "I point this end," I joked, having never fired a damn gun in my short human life.
"Aim down the barrel, hold your breath, and pull the trigger. Don't think too hard about what happens after."
Andrews swung himself over the hood of his car and fired, the blast deafening and terrible. My ears rang in a pitch that ached beyond words, my shoulders locked upward in a state of shock. Our other crew members were all huddled behind the rest of the caravan, shooting back at the bandits racing over on horseback. Sand kicked up in tiny blasts as bullets skipped across the ground, shouting and gunfire coming from all directions. I tried to mimic Andrews, throwing myself over the hood to shoot back at the danger, but my glasses were wet from sweat and smeared from dirt. I focused on a blur and fired, ducking back down and trying to keep myself from shaking. Andrews gave a holler to someone in our party, took a peek over the car, and ran. I stared after him, abandoned and terrified. One tire of the car popped, the vehicle lurching to the side as it deflated. I ducked down and yelled, scanning for another safe place to run. Cowering behind a car in the middle of the desert was not how I was going to die. I had survived the jaws of a rather large tyrannosaur, almost got stepped on by a sauropod many times, was stabbed by a ceratopsian. I was trying to steal an egg, so that was my fault, actually. And dropped off a cliff by a hadrosaur in my other life. A band of human bandits was not going to seal my fate. With my new resolve firmly in place, I gripped my rifle and got my feet back under me. I made to sprint to a neighboring vehicle when I noticed a person near the fossil site. A man was standing over the newly uncovered skull, gun in hand, and my pick in the other. Andrews and the others were still firing at the other bandits, unaware one had made their way past our defenses. I didn't wait to find out if the man had any intentions of cracking a piece of the find for himself, or if he was just someone appreciating our handiwork. I braced my rifle against my shoulder and stood, marching over to the intruder with all the bravery I had left. "You there! Stop!" I contemplated the languages I had under my command and realized I had limited options in that situation. My attempt at repeating the same order in Mongolian and Chinese were fumbled and terrible, but it got the man's attention. His wide-brimmed hat was secured on his head, but the cloth that had been used to keep sand from his face had fallen around his chin. High cheekbones gave an elegant structure to his face, his almond eyes a surprising shade of pale blue-gray, almost like a shale. Dark facial hair covered his upper lip and jaw, skin tanned to a golden tawny shade. I was unaware of how tall the fellow was until I worked up the nerve to draw in closer, motioning with my rifle to get away from the skull. "Back away. Go." I swallowed my nerves, reaching up to quickly push my glasses up my nose.
"You said orange,"
the bandit said in perfect English. I blinked. "Pardon?" The Mongolian was correct. "But you said orange in Chinese." "Oh, well, I meant to say stop." "I gathered as much," he said slowly, like one would speak to a child, clearly not at all afraid of me. I was never the type who needed to be feared or scary, so it wasn't in my repertoire. Still, I gave my best attempt at seeming like a formidable bastard with a dead-eye shot and aimed the rifle right at him with intent. "You best be going now, sir." I adjusted my hands on the weapon. "I don't want to have to shoot you, but I will."
What did you find? He inclined his head at the skull. What is that?
A fossil. Prehistoric life.
I cleared my throat, attempting to sound much mightier than I felt.
I'll have you know we're here under the protection of the United States of America.
Once again, he was undaunted.
A fossil of what?
I don't know. A new species, I think. I glanced at it, then shrugged.
Some big mammal, we think.
What are you going to do with it?
That's none of your concern, sir. I pinched one eye shut, aiming at him. You better turn tail or I'm going to shoot.
He sounded so bored when he spoke.
No, you're not.
I will. You don't know what I'm capable of.
My feet slid me just a hair closer. If you so much as breathe on that fossil, I'll do you in. Gunfire popped off around us, a bullet pinging near my foot causing me to dance sideways. The mysterious bandit didn't so much as flinch as a stray shot bounced off the cliffside near him. I envied how foolishly calm the man could be in such chaos, but then again, humans had the ability to be blind to danger. My instincts roared to run, take cover, and hide until the threat was gone. I was damned good at doing that. I dared say I had perfected it. Yet I shoved all of those wonderful and beneficial feelings aside and stood my ground. My fingers shook, and my glasses slid down my nose again, but I kept my eyes trained on the bandit. He spun my pick in his hand, flipping it up and catching it again in a lazy, practiced motion. The sand shifted under his foot as he took a step towards me.
You stay back.
Another step. Eyes fixed on me in a look I was all too familiar with. Predatory. Dangerous.
Run, run, run.
I swallowed.
I don't want to shoot you. Do not test me.
Unblinking gray eyes pinned me, his large stature catching the shadows of the late afternoon sun. He moved slow and calm, one foot in front of the other, having all the time in the world to stalk me. If my feathers were on display, they would have been standing in a ridge down my back. My tail wanted to fan out and help me seem bigger than I was. The urge to squawk and snap my teeth made me clamp my jaw shut. Something in his eyes had my primal self clawing to be freed. My skin tightened as my bones tried to flex and break. I made an agonizing grunt and forced it back, my vision blinking into sharper focus for only an instant. And there, just for a moment, a fraction of a breath, I saw it in his eyes. Recognition. His gray eyes shifted, pupil expanding, and I saw the other in him clear as day. Big, scary, teeth. My rifle bucked against my shoulder, the explosion a blast of sound that knocked the hearing from my left ear. The bandit spun, his right shoulder pitching backwards and taking the rest of him with it. I said something then, a series of nonsense and practiced American curses and idioms, and dropped my rifle like the thing was haunted. Of course, I had been the one to pull the trigger. I felt the pressure of the thing against my finger right before the blast, but the resulting violence repulsed me, and I refused to take part of it again. Throughout my impossibly long life, I had never killed anything without meaning to eat it. Even when I had fought for mates, I never murdered my rivals. Nor did I even strike fatally when escaping something, trying to make a meal of me. It simply wasn't something I ever had the strength to do. Somehow, in the span of mere seconds, I had devastated another person over a slab of rock. I had never been so horrified and deeply ashamed. Granted, shame was a new emotion for me at the time, and damn, was it a beast to wrangle. The poor fellow on the ground groaned in agony, his long body curling in on itself in pain. I rushed to him, feeling the desperate need to right the wrong I had committed.
You damn fool, I told you to go.
I tore his hand away from his shoulder, feeling lightheaded at the bloom of blood seeping through the torn fabric. His handsome features twisted into a horror show of pain, teeth bared and eyes wrung shut.
Mr. Thomas.
I spun toward Andrews's voice, relieved to see him jogging my way. I shot this man, I yelled once he was close enough. I hit him. He's bleeding.
They tend to do that when you shoot them,
Andrews answered sardonically, eyeing the fallen bandit. I swiveled between Andrews and the bleeding man. What do we do? Andrews glanced in the direction of the now silent gunfight, squinting at the horizon before kneeling down beside my victim.
His friends left him behind. Probably think he's dead. You there.
Andrews leaned forward, making it known he was speaking to the bandit.
You speak English?
The bandit gave a quick nod, exhaling a rough breath of anguish.
Try and hold still,
Andrews cautioned him, tearing more of the fabric away from his shoulder to examine the wound. Blood covered most of his shoulder. The ugly hole punched through his skin shone with the bullet that hadn't quite passed through the muscle. It was a hideous sight, carnal and vicious, and I felt a piece of myself wither. One of the native Mongolians in the crew was brought over to assist, bringing with him a mixture of Western and Eastern medicine to help mend the wound. A piece of leather was shoved between the bandit's teeth, and he clamped down tight.
Thomas, help me hold him steady. We need to get that bullet out or he's done for.
Andrews placed me at the bandit's side, and I grabbed him like it was my entire purpose for living. The screams that ripped through the air as the hunk of metal was scooped from the bandit's shoulder were unlike any noises I had heard before. Roars, screeches, grunts, even the last dying breath of a tiny animal in my jaws was nothing compared to a human man being tortured. I felt the urge to cry. I wanted to sob. I was thankful everyone's attention was on the wound. The bandit's head fell back as the bullet was extracted, the wound washed clean with water, swabbed with medicinal herbs and Western disinfectants before the final piece of agony was bestowed on him. The wound was cauterized shut to keep him from bleeding out further, and the pain knocked him completely unconscious while making me sickened to the point of vomiting. I was thankful Andrews didn't comment that I wasn't able to handle the gore. Is he going to live? I managed to ask once I had returned from tossing my lunch. The bandit was pale and limp, blood covering his clothing and bandages over his shoulder.
If he can make it through the next few nights without getting a fever, he'll be all right. Sore and miserable, but alive. We just need a place to put him until he can get on a horse and get back to wherever he came from.
I swallowed down the last traces of my illness, but the guilt was still vile on the back of my tongue. He can stay with me. I'll watch over him. This is my fault, after all.
You're a better man than most, Thomas.
Andrews gave my shoulder a squeeze.
I think most people would have just let the bastard bleed.
I wasn't sure how to comment on that, so I didn't. Instead, I helped carry the unconscious thief to my already cramped tent, letting him take my bedroll while he recovered. The Mongolian man who had helped us gave me a collection of remedies for the bandit, including water, milk, some medicine for his wounds, fresh bandages, and a strip of paper with a language on it I couldn't read. I was told very clearly he was to eat the paper when he woke up. I placed it by the water so I didn't forget. After the excitement of the afternoon, the dig wasn't as enthusiastic. Many of the crew were shaken, but thankful no one in our expedition had been harmed. Two other bandits had been shot, but they managed to flee on horseback. I apparently was a decent shot, though I felt like a damn monster. It was hours before any life came back to the bandit. The sun was setting, the desert cooling to a freezing temperature I could never fully get used to. Nerves kept me from relaxing into the book I was trying to enjoy, my stomach still not quite settling, when the bandit gave a weak grunt. His lips moved slowly, peeling apart from lack of moisture.
Water.
I tucked a pillow under his head and lifted the canteen to his lips, letting him drink as much as he wanted. His tongue chased after a drop, his throat bobbing as his eyes cracked open. I checked him for a fever, his brow clammy against my palm. I was told you should be all right as long as you don't get a fever. He swallowed again, eyes drifting around the tent. You're in my tent, I supplied, hopefully in a helpful way. You're safe.
You shot me.
I did. I cleared my throat. But the bullet is out, and you've been given medicine and properly bandaged. I've been instructed to make sure you drink water and milk for your strength. Though this is fermented milk, and it's disgusting, but I'm not going to argue. He nodded.
Give me the milk. Everything hurts.
I did as he commanded, helping him to sip down the horrendous concoction that the Mongolians and many of my fellow crewmates adored. When he settled back into the pillow, I used a little of our water to wet a wrung-out bandana and dab the sweat from his brow. His bandages needed changing, and I did so with as much care as I could muster. The wound didn't seem too angry, and I allowed myself to feel relief that maybe the poor bastard wouldn't die in my tent. Nightfall plunged the desert into darkness, the temperature dropping sharply into a biting cold. I placed myself on the side of the bandit that didn't have a hole in it, sharing my blankets to make sure he didn't freeze. Every couple of hours he'd stir, pained and groaning, and I'd give him whatever it was he needed to settle back into a fitful sleep. For 2 days I kept the man alive. Each day he was a little more conscious, a touch more of a person than a corpse. I helped change out his bandages, fed him broth or milk, and slept next to him to make sure he had whatever he needed. By some divine luck or godly intervention, his wound never festered. Maybe the horrible milk was medicinal after all. Oh, you're awake, I greeted him as I climbed into our tent after a full day of digging. Dirt and sand clung to me. My glasses had a new chip at the bottom, and it was splintering my vision horribly. The skull discovered during the faded shootout that had gained me a ward was nearly chopped free from the rock, and we were optimistic that we could get it transported soon. The bandit blinked at me, his long hair free from the braid it had been tied back in. His beard had become scruffy, and the man was overdue for a proper bath. Shale, blue-gray eyes watched me as I crawled over to him, sitting on the makeshift bed beside his. He didn't flinch as I went through the routine of checking his wound and his brow for fever. How are you feeling?
Better than yesterday, he said, voice slightly hoarse from lack of use. He cringed as he worked his tongue in his mouth. All I can taste is that damn milk.
That's all you've really had for days. I tugged my bag over, digging through the contents until I found what I was after. The tiny, wrapped candies had made it across the ocean, and I saved them for the days I was feeling particularly homesick. Pulling each twisted end, the candy spun and the paper unfolded, exposing a little drop of sugary confection purchased for a penny. Here, I offered, putting it to his lips. It's American candy, one of my favorites. He furrowed his brows, examining the foreign object like I was holding a bug to his face. It's good. It's sugar. I urged the candy past his lips, and he took it carefully with his tongue. The candy rolled against his teeth, and he considered it, his brows lifting with a tiny jump. I smiled at his reaction, and his eyes fixed on me. It's called a Mary Jane. I think it's molasses and butter? I don't know. Either way, it's a favorite. Do they have candy like that in Mongolia?
There's candy all over the world, he said. But this is pretty good.
I've got 3 left, and they're all yours. His head rested back on the pillow, the candy clacking as he worked it over with his tongue. Exhaustion and pain had bruised under his eyes, his skin sticky with sweat and dried blood. It was the most movement and life I had seen from him since he stood over the fossil. Even with the strain of the wound and fighting against death, his eyes held the predatory sharpness from days prior.
Why did you save me? He asked after a time.
For a beat, I hesitated, fearing maybe I had projected what I wanted to see. Something familiar. A long-lost connection to a world I used to know. Maybe even camaraderie. You and I said very carefully.
are the same. You see it, don't you? In my eyes? I see it in yours. The candy in his mouth slowed. Tell me you see it. I was whispering, no doubt sounding like a man unhinged. You have another side. A beast. The same type of monsters we're uncovering out here in the desert. I do too. I'm one of you. His pupils flexed as I leaned closer, tugging my glasses off. Tell me you see it, I demanded again, the claws of my prehistoric animal scratching to be free. My skin chilled with a tug to shift into feathers. My bones tightened like they wanted to break apart and reform. If my tail had been free, it would have flared its feathers out, and I would have flexed my claws. Just a blink, a breath, and I would have pulled my other side to the surface and run through the desert like my theropod cousins used to. The urge to taste the desert wind on my dinosaur tongue almost made me come undone. A finger graced my cheek, jerking me back to my human mind so fast I gasped. He retracted his hand, eyes still transfixed on me. I see it. I felt a strange tumbling in my chest at how he said those words. The tent flap was pulled back and I jerked, blinking quickly as Andrews leaned in.
Ah, he's awake.
Andrews kneeled half inside the tent.
Good. We need to move camp and get these fossils back to New York.
Right now? I blurted, and Andrews nodded.
We can beat the sunset if we start moving now. You there.
He nodded to the bandit.
Time for you to get going. We saved your horse for you so you can get traveling back to where you came from.
He can't ride a horse in the state he's in.
Sure he can. People out here are born on horses. He'll be fine. You've done more than anyone else would have, Thomas. You're a good man. Now, help me get our fossil on the car.
But...
That a boy.
He stood from the tent, holding the flap back as he whistled out to the crew.
Come, help get this bandit on a horse. We need to move.
I was stuck between wanting to spring from the tent to assist with the fossil and telling Andrews to get lost for 5 damn minutes. Unfortunately, the choice was made for me by Erdine all but shoving me out of the tent so he could assist the bandit. I was tugged along to the fossil, but my attention was split between managing the weight of the slab of rock and watching the bandit emerging from our tent. He moved stiffly and slow, like his body had forgotten how to handle its limbs. Erdine passed him supplies and his horse, and I stared with a growing pit in my stomach as the bandit swung onto his horse. Strangely, it hurt. I couldn't grasp why. I waited for him to turn around so I could wave goodbye, but he didn't. He left without a backwards glance. There was no reason for me to be in such a sour mood after getting our hard-won fossil plucked from the earth and secured into the Dodge. It was the entire reason we had gallivanted into the hellish dunes of the Mongolian desert. But it felt like a hollow victory. I felt like someone had punched a hole right through my chest. Which was terribly ironic, considering I had punched a real hole through someone's torso. There's a human concept of karma that felt appropriate in that moment. After packing up our campsite, I tied my tent and supplies down and climbed into the seat saved for me. The bouncing tumble of the drive across the dunes wasn't as exciting going back. As a means of coping with my stormy disposition, I reached for my last remaining supply of Mary Janes, saddened I wasn't able to keep my promise to give them to the bandit. There was only one left, the others having been swiped on his way out. I ate my last piece of candy, thinking of blue-gray eyes. Chapter 1. You. Present Day. The winter wind was cold on my snout. Blooms of heat from my nostrils swirled in the frigid air as I tracked my prey, the scent faint in the snow. White coated the landscape, a blanket of powdery starlight under the bright moon. Dented in the pillowy surface were hooved tracks, crushed under my larger taloned feet. My feathers kept me protected from the icy chill, the snow flurries melting against them. I was hungry, desperately hungry, not only for the nourishment of the meat I was chasing, but for the ancient art of the hunt. I could feel this drive in my bones, in the very essence of my being. Soul, consciousness, instinct, whatever one called it, to stalk, strike, and eat. It was all-consuming and powerful, the urge as vital as breathing. Slipping into my alternate self was gratifying and familiar, and I didn't stifle any of its needs. As a human, I consumed art and language, experienced delicacies of flesh and culture until my heart was full. I paid the same respect to my uteranus side. We were one and the same, two halves of a whole, and tonight, my beast side wanted to hunt. So I went hunting. One set of tracks. Heavy, wide hooves. I inhaled the heady scent of fur, the unmistakable smell of male glands just beyond the tree line. Scrapes in the bark from the stag's antlers marked its territory, and I followed the trail my meal left behind. The treetops swayed and creaked. A smaller cousin hooted above from its nest. Scurries of smaller things unworthy of my time darted away from under my feet, except for one curious fox who watched from nearby. The deer was close. Its smell hinted at a trace of fear. It knew something was lurking. For a moment, my mind drifted back to the forests of my younger days. The snow wasn't quite as heavy. Only flurries and occasional storms would pass through and coat the ground in soft, fragile layers of white. The winters were still harrowing to those not equipped for the climate, and I remember stepping over the bones of those who dared to stay past their welcome in the northern tundra. Even the giants could freeze. The bones I stepped over now were much smaller, tiny little things picked clean from the mammals that dominated this world. So much fur and hooves now. I missed being able to see flashes of feathers, mighty horns, and impossible heights as I hunted for my dinner. Even without the giants in the landscape, the hunt was still refreshing and delicious. And I loved the taste of venison. A strong whiff of stag stilled me, my body growing as still as the night air. My vision was sharp, my sense of smell sublime. I could see the soft movement of the handsome, strong creature picking at the meager offerings of the forest floor. He was cautious, ears swiveling as his head lifted to scan for danger. Powerful branches grew from his skull, old and strong. This was an old man who had evaded danger for years. It would be an honor to have him. I waited, poised and calm, having as much patience as I did time. My mouth opened to roll his scent across my tongue, taste his smell, and remember it. If he vanished, I would find him again. His head dipped, and I crept closer, my white feathers confusing from a distance in the snowy forest he called home. Closer. Careful. One step at a time. A snap, a branch popping underfoot, and the stag was off. His body fired through the forest with grace and speed, springing over the ground in a perfect series of gallops and bounces. I flanked left, my stride fast and careful. I wasn't as dexterous in the forest, my long legs made for sprinting down my prey and not dancing over obstacles. I had to be smart, think like a scared animal fleeing from danger. It ran from noise, towards areas it knew predators would have a hard time following. But I was no large cat or a pack of wolves. I was a tyrannosaur. Nothing got in my way. The old stag made a calculated risk, darting out into an open space to try and gain speed. Stamina was something deer had in spades, outpacing their hunters with quick diversions and exhausting them. He wasn't expecting me. I should have been dead for millions of years. His risk failed him. I was too fast. My stride was easy and quick, unencumbered by trees. My jaws snapped around his body like a spring-loaded trap. Teeth tore, pressure crushed bone, and the dying stag cried out one last time before its old body finally gave up. Under the light of a winter moon, I had my dinner. Mammalian meat and wonderful warm bone marrow, hide that ripped easily under my serrated teeth.
While I missed the bountiful hunts of the past, with prey so large I could barely consume it all, it was lovely to have mammal meat. I much preferred the taste of anything with hooves. If I was feeling in a particular mood, sometimes things with feathers, too. Occasionally, I dabbled in offerings from the sea, though I was a bit pickier with what I enjoyed. Being a carnivore was great. I took my time eating, savoring every bit of the animal I could digest properly before retreating. The cabin wasn't far, just tucked back enough from civilization to ensure no one would come knocking. It was my favorite American safe house, and one that I had unofficially claimed as my own. I shook my feathers clear of snow before shrinking down. The sharp sting of the bitter cold against my human skin was uncomfortable, to say the least, but I dashed inside before it could bite too deep. I pulled the plush blanket from the back of the couch and wrapped up, meandering to the kitchen to turn on the electric kettle. After dinner, tea was essential. My phone hummed against the kitchen counter where I had left it plugged in, and I tapped the speakerphone option while I went through my tea containers. "You're up late, Montana?" I shook my oolong canister and frowned. "Did Baja stay at my safe house again?" "It's not yours, it's ours," his voice rumbled through the speaker. "He owes me a canister of oolong. This was my Iron Goddess tea." "I'll pass that along. I have something for you." I sighed at the paltry remains of my favorite tea and pulled down another blend, scooping out what I needed. "Let's have it." "I sent a file. We have intel about something big being traded in China. It's being called something of a holy grail when it comes to fossils, but the language barrier is getting in the way. Royal was able to translate a lot of it, but my Chinese is spotty. I wanted you to take a look." I secured the lid on the tea and tapped at my phone, bringing up the email correspondence Montana had sent my way. The emails dated back almost a year of communication, someone tracking down rare and expensive pieces. Royal's computer translations did the bulk of the work, but missed important nuances of the languages. Certain phrases were much more formal between parties, others casual and even friendly, and it seemed like this deal had been brokered over the heads of important people. All of that aside, it was verbiage used to describe the fossil that caught my attention. This wasn't fossilized bone, nor was it impressions or trace fossils. "Montana, this is an amber fossil." I heard him make a low hum, a noise he reserved for the few times he was surprised. "You're sure?" "From how they're describing it, I'm fairly sure. They mention that it was found in Myanmar. Has Royal dug up any pictures or photos?" I browsed through more of the emails, hoping for an attachment. "Negative. They've kept all photo evidence off the web. We had a hunch it was something big. I wasn't expecting amber." Do they have a rendezvous schedule?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.